There's a very serious syndrome out there. It's called shiny object syndrome. Whenever we see something new, we are automatically drawn towards it. And for a brief period of time, our minds stop working. We fail to realize that we might not even need this thing. And it's only after the excitement passes away and we are stuck with the product, we begin our thinking. We start to realize that we have made a big blunder and some company or some person definitely tricked us into buying something we do not need. And now, my friend, the damage is done. Hardly anyone is immune to this syndrome, but don't worry, there's a cure, and that cure is knowledge. If you are thinking about subscribing to some NFO or if you are thinking about starting a new mutual fund, then you need a reality check, and I am Money Minded Mandeep, the guy who's going to give you one. Before I explain you the horrors of NFO or a new mutual fund, think about why do people subscribe to NFO or why do people buy a new mutual fund? People mistake NFO for an IPO, but it's not. You see, IPO is completely different. Some private company finally decides to go public. That means their existing investors are either wanting to sell their stake at a higher price or they want to issue fresh shares to public so that they can raise money and that money will be used to expand their business. And more often than not, at least for the last 2 years, we have seen some huge listing gains in most of the IPOs. But NFO, which is called a new fund offer, is simply not an IPO. It's just another mutual fund that will pool investors' money and invest in certain areas according to their objective. So it's still going to invest your money in stocks that are already public, it's still going to invest your money in bonds that are already tradable, and it's not going to invest your money in something as new as IPO. It's just that in order to successfully launch a new mutual fund, an AMC is required to launch an NFO, which is called a new fund offer, that lasts between 10 to 15 days, and during that period, they encourage new investors to put money in their fund, and after 10 or 15 days, whatever money they have collected, they start to invest that money according to their objective. Bottom line, you will not miss out on anything if you do not invest your money during an NFO, and if you decide to invest your money later on into that mutual fund via regular methods like SIP or lump sum. Second reason, we think lower NAV means more units and higher returns, but it does not. Let's say you have 10,000 rupees and you want to invest this money. Now I'm giving you two scenarios, mutual fund 1 and mutual fund 2. On January 1st, the NAV of mutual fund 1 is 100 rupees and the NAV of mutual fund 2 is merely 10 rupees. If you decide to invest your 10,000 rupees in mutual fund 1, you will get 100 units. And if you invest the same amount in mutual fund 2, you will get 1,000 units. Now there's an assumption that both mutual funds gain 30% in 1 year. On December 31st, the NAV of mutual fund 1 would be 130 rupees and NAV of mutual fund 2 would be 13 rupees. And now you want to withdraw your money. So the number of units you hold multiplied by the NAV, that means the price of one unit, gives you the amount that you will get. In mutual fund 1, you will get 13,000 rupees and in mutual fund 2, you will get 13,000 rupees. The conclusion is NAV does not matter. The amount you are investing matters and your percentage gain matters. Whether you get one unit or you get 100 units, it doesn't matter at all. Third reason why people invest in NFO is that they fail to realize that the world, or let's say India, has more than 5,000 plus mutual fund schemes and that their needs, however bizarre they are, can still be fulfilled with those existing mutual funds. Now let's understand why do AMCs launch NFOs and whether there's some hidden agenda. So the number one reason that you should know is they get to earn higher expense ratio. If you don't know what expense ratio is, here's a quick crash course. A mutual fund scheme will first pool investors' money and then invest that money in certain areas, let's say stocks. And you are giving your money to a certain qualified fund manager who is responsible to invest your money and generate good enough returns on it. Now, why would that person do all this work free of cost? He will obviously charge a fund management fee. But fund management fee is merely one component of an expense ratio. The second component can be distributor's commission. Almost all mutual fund schemes have two versions. One is a direct plan, the other one is a regular plan. If you go via regular plan, that means there's a middleman involved in between who will continue to get distributor's commission as long as you stay invested. And if you go via direct plan, and I'll tell you how, you can save that distributor's commission. Another component can be advertising or marketing expenses. And then there are some taxes and charges applicable to a mutual fund. No mutual fund is allowed to ask for charges separately. All have to be clubbed in one single percentage form, and that is called expense ratio. So all in all, an expense ratio will sum up all the charges that you need to pay to a mutual fund house in order to invest your money. And this expense ratio is the income of AMC who's running the mutual fund. Let me quickly explain how expense ratio works. SEBI in 2019 revised its guidelines on the maximum cap on expense ratio that any AMC is allowed to charge. So here's the expense ratio slabs for equity mutual funds in front of you. On the AUM of first 500 crores, a mutual fund can only charge a maximum of 2.25% expense ratio. From 500 crores to 750 crores, they can charge a maximum of 2% expense ratio. From 750 to 2000 crores, they can charge a maximum of 1.75%. On the next 3000 crores, they only charge 1.6% maximum. On the next 5000 crores, they can charge maximum of 1.5%. And this expense ratio gets reduced by 0.05% with every addition of 5000 crores. And the part of AUM that finally crosses 50,000 crores, any mutual fund is allowed to charge only a maximum of 1.05% expense ratio. Schemes other than equity has a similar kind of slab structure, but 0.25% less in each slab. Now let's look at this example. Let's say a mutual fund has an AUM of 5,000 crores and we want to calculate the maximum expense ratio any mutual fund house can charge. So on the first 500 crores, they will charge 2.25% and that will amount to 11.25 crores. On the next 250 crores, they will charge 5 crore rupees at the rate of 2%. On the next 1250 crores, they can charge 21.9 crore at the rate of 1.75%. On the next 3000 crores, they can charge 48 crores at the rate of 1.6%. And this makes their total income from the expense ratio at 86.15 crores. Now, if you divide this 86.15 crores with the total AUM of 5000 crores, you will get the weighted average expense ratio, that is also called TER, total expense ratio, 1.72%. So on the AUM of 5000 crores, a mutual fund can maximum charge 1.72% of expense ratio. Now here I present the conundrum. Let's say more investors are willing to invest money in this mutual fund and the total fresh investment is somewhere around 500 crores. So if an additional 500 crores come into this mutual fund, then the AMC can only charge expense ratio at 1.5% according to the slab, and that will amount to the additional income of 7.5 crore rupees. But let's say instead of doing this, I start a new mutual fund and I get a fresh investment of 500 crores. Then the slab changes and I'm now allowed to charge expense ratio at 2.25%, and that will give me a total income of 11.25 crores against 7.5 crores which I would have otherwise gotten. So the AMCs have good incentive to launch an NFO. They will earn higher expense ratio, they will be able to pay higher distributors commission, and that all is coming out of your pocket. So while it may make business sense for the AMCs to launch an NFO, it does not make sense for you to blindly invest in them without identifying your needs first. Now, I must also tell you that hardly any AMC will decide to charge the expense ratio at the highest slab because mutual funds are too competitive. And it's also worth noting that expense ratio of a regular plan will be way higher than the expense ratio of a direct plan. Most regular plans will have an expense ratio above 1.5%, sometimes 2%, and most direct plans have an expense ratio somewhere close to 1%. I have a mutual fund that is charging me only 0.4% expense ratio. Please do not ask me which mutual fund is that, because I don't want you to invest just because of lower expense ratio. I want you to wait for next video. If you found this video helpful till now, then it deserves a like and a share to someone who really needs to watch this, because a lot of people are investing in 10, 15, 20 mutual funds for no reason at all. And if you also want me to make a video where I explain how to declutter your mutual fund portfolio from 10 funds to maybe 2 funds, then you can let me know in the comment section. Also, if you want to start investing in mutual funds or if you want to start investing in stocks, I'm leaving 2 links for you in the description. One is a mutual fund app, which is my favorite, Kuvera app. It will show you the direct plans. You can save distributors commission, end up paying a much lower expense ratio, and a lower expense ratio means higher returns for you. And downloading plus using the app is absolutely free of cost. The second link is for a DMAT account. Now, you may be a beginner to investing, but I'm not asking you to go and invest lakhs and lakhs of rupees into stocks, and stocks need higher research than mutual funds. All I'm saying is, open a demat account with India's best broker who doesn't charge brokerage on investing and try buying a 500 rupees share. That will create some skin in the game and you will feel motivated to watch more and more of these YouTube videos. Maybe not mine, maybe some other videos. I don't mind, but you will get to start your investing as early as possible. So please do check out those links. This video is not sponsored by any brand, but if you use those links to open your demat account, then we will get a small kickback that will keep us rolling and we will make more free of cost videos for you. The second reason why AMCs love to launch an NFO is size fatigue. You see, the problem is if you give me 1000 rupees and ask me to invest that money, I'll invest 1000 rupees and I'll generate an extra 1000 rupees on top of it. That means 100% return. But if you give me 1000 crore rupees, I might fail. Let's take an example of a small cap fund with an AUM of 5000 crore rupees. Now it will primarily invest the money in small cap stocks. And the problem is it might not find good enough small cap stocks that can be bought in huge quantities. So they may be able to identify a good small cap stock. But because of unavailability of enough number of shares, they are only able to invest a mere 100 crore rupees out of their 5000 crore rupees. Now let's say that 100 crore rupees generate 100% returns, means 100 crores becomes 200 crores. But a profit of 100 crores on an AUM of 5000 crores will mean just 4% returns. So sooner or later, most mutual funds will feel size fatigue. Small cap funds may start to feel that fatigue by 5000 crores or 7000 crore rupees, whereas large caps are still safe till 10,000 crores, 15,000 crores, maybe 25,000 crores, simply because you can buy huge quantities of large cap stocks. But size fatigue is bound to happen someday, and it becomes harder and harder for a mutual fund manager to consistently outperform its benchmark. And if they consistently underperform, investors will lose confidence, goodwill will take a hit, and in simple words, business will take a hit. What's the solution? There are two. First, they will restrict fresh investments in the existing mutual funds, or they may decide to launch a new mutual fund via NFO. Third reasons why AMCs love to launch NFO is to hide bad performance of their existing mutual funds. I think all of us would agree that a mutual fund cannot be expected to generate consistent returns every year, every month, every quarter. But a lot of investors always rely on past returns to pick a mutual fund. And if they see bad performance, they will simply ignore that mutual fund. To be honest, that's not the right approach. You have to consider a lot more factors than just past returns to pick a mutual fund. And if you want to know how to do that, I can plan a video. But unfortunately, a lot of retail investors do use this criteria to pick mutual funds. And the NFO is the only way the AMC can attract new investors by saying that whatever happened, happened, and it's in the past. Now we are back with a new hotshot mutual fund and poor returns are history. The fourth point is kind of a relief actually. It's about the categorization of mutual funds. So SEBI has mentioned a total of 36 categories of mutual funds, and they've also stated that no AMC is allowed to have more than one mutual fund in one category. Now, what are those categories? They can be large cap or large cap plus mid cap or flexi cap or multi cap or small cap. You know where I'm going. So the good thing is if the total categories are 36 and AMCs can only have a maximum of 36 mutual funds, or can they? The 36th and the last category is interesting. It's called thematic mutual funds. And for this, SEBI has left it to AMCs to form their own themes. And themes can be more than one. One theme could be ESG, environmental, social, and governance. Another theme could be international stocks. So under the 36th category, an AMC can launch as many mutual funds as long as the themes are different. All in all, my point is, while NFO may mean business sense for the AMCs, you have to first identify your own requirement before making a decision to invest in that particular fund. So should you invest in NFO? There's not a clear yes or no answer because I don't know who's watching and who's not, and everyone has their own set of needs, but I can certainly help you decide. First point, please do not mistake NFO for an IPO. You will not get any extraordinary gains just by thinking that it works like an IPO. It definitely does not work like an IPO. Second point, there is no proven track record of an NFO because it has just begun. And I know I've only told you that you should not only look at past returns, but a track record shows you so much more than just returns. It shows you a lot more data, and I'd be happy to make a video of how to pick mutual funds. You can just let me know. Third point, however bizarre your needs are, I'm sure existing 5000 plus mutual funds in India can suit your needs very well. And fourth point, if you think you have some kind of a need that only an NFO can fulfill, then why not? I don't want to stop you to invest in a new mutual fund or subscribe to a new NFO. It depends on the fact that who is launching that mutual fund, what is their main objective? Is their main objective is to just make more profit, or are they really onto something and this NFO will certainly give more returns? So I will always consider an NFO if it's being launched by someone that I trust or some company that I trust. And with this video, I wanted to tell you that even if you are thinking of going for NFO, it should be for all the right reasons and not the wrong reasons. If you like this video, please hit the like button. Let YouTube Baba know that this is a good video they can suggest to other viewers and we can get some more subscribers. That being said, I will see you in the next video. Bye.